indeed a warm welcome. Mr. Edward Robinson, Managing Director for Economic Policy at the Monetary Authority of Singapore. Mr. Vicky Bendra, the President of Asia Pacific, Middle East and Africa for MasterCard Worldwide. Mr. Lin Tion, the Chairman of our Sim Kee Boon Institute for Financial Economics. Distinguished guests, colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, a warm welcome, as I already said, but also my best wishes for the new year. I'm not sure whether it's for the past new year or for the next new year, but in this time of the year here in Singapore, I don't go wrong by wishing good luck, right? I'm also very happy to see you here today and that you are able to join us on this very special occasion when we mark the first anniversary of the launch of the Singapore Index of Inflation Expectations, or SInDEx in short. I'm actually not sure how I have to pronounce this because the SI and the DE are in capitals and the N and the X in mind. You have to shout C in DE or something like that. To SInDEx, right? That domain, right? Easy. It's only actually a year ago that we gathered here at SMU to celebrate the birth of that new index, which emerged from that partnership between MasterCard Worldwide and SMU. We're also, and I keep on saying this in many different occasions and in many different environments, we as a university, as SMU, we pride ourselves to be, and we call it in our strapline, the University for the World of Business and Management. We're happy that we can express that being a university for the business of, for the world of business and management by reaching out to companies, by working with companies, and we're very happy that we can do that with MasterCard, which is a truly iconic corporate institution. We do that because here at SMU, we recognize that teaching, research, and practice are actually very closely connected. I would say that our research here at SMU is unique. Maybe that's a little bit strong because there are other places in the world where they connect research to practice, but it is quite unique to be an organization where we have sort of a blend of practice-driven research and research-driven practice. So we believe in research and practice, but we believe in a very strong cross-fertilization between the two, between the research and the practice. And indeed, one of the expressions of that is that 30% of our faculty are on the practice track and work closely together with the more research-oriented faculty. Those close linkages that we have with the business world and the corporate world have resulted actually in very interesting and prominent research that is applicable to our partners in the business area. It is heartening for me to know that the research that is done here at SMU is not only academic, and I will stress that it is important to be academic, but at the same time that we create impact by being revealing, innovative, by being relevant to industry and the community. Our research teams at the Sim Kee Boon Institute for Financial Economics, I'll talk from now onwards on by SKBI, right, have performed outstanding research with industrial relevance, and that includes the early detection system of asset price bubbles, the Singapore Corporate Governance Index, as well as this SInDEx. I remind you that in August of 2011, the research team at SKBI and MasterCard started to explore and conduct research on what drives really inflation expectations. The research led to a timely, relevant, yet rigorous inquiry into a topic that is close to the heart of myself, I have to say, but also every Singapore household, because inflation is something that we are closely connected to in our daily lives, right? These inflation expectations measured our perceptions of future average rise in prices over a medium term of 1 year or over a longer term of 5 years. The study of inflation expectations of Singapore households is a multidisciplinary, industry-relevant research. The research team applied very rigorous methods using current internet-based marketing survey tools for the data collection and advanced econometric techniques to analyze the data. It is clear that policymakers and central banks around the world, while formulating their monetary policies, keep a keen eye on the inflation expectations, among other things. However, their projections are mostly based on the expected rise in prices of a fixed basket of goods and services at current or prevailing prices, popularly termed as headline inflation, consumer price index inflation, or CPI inflation. And we know, of course, that when you work with these fixed basket of goods and services, that there can be some distortions. I was reminded that of that yesterday when we had the Minister of Trade of Indonesia as a visitor yesterday speaking here at SMU, and he told us that a significant part of the Indonesian inflation index is driven by Chile, and so that you could influence the Indonesian inflation index by eating less hot food. I'm not sure he really meant it, but it does indicate an example of where inflation indexes can be slightly adjusted or, because of the fixed aspect of goods. There's usually proxies for the future rise in overall prices to enable policymakers to decide on their monetary policy to keep prices stable, while at the same time encouraging growth and generating employment. But one of the biggest challenges for policymakers, however, is to ascertain the inflation expectations of households before and after any policy statement is made. While the experts no doubt have access to vast levels of macroeconomic data to formulate informed opinions about inflation expectations, for the common man who has to make purchasing decisions as unprecedented levels of global economy uncertainty falls, the reality can be very, very different. Our research at SMU SKBI thus brings out the nature and influences of such individuals' inflation expectations from cross-sections of Singapore households. In addition, the research team also proposed two new composite-weighted inflation indexes, namely the one-year ahead SInDEx 1 and the five-year ahead SInDEx 5. Singapore Index of Inflation Expectations, or SInDEx 1, provides an alternative to standard inflation expectations measures and turns out to be actually quite effective in its brief history, as we no doubt will hear a little bit later. The early results are indeed fascinating in terms of both response and predictability, and are testament to how informed the Singapore households are and how grounded they are in forming their inflation expectations. It also brings out the effectiveness of our methodology that is founded upon, as I already said, rigorous multidisciplinary research expertise by our SKBI researchers. As far as I understand, the updates from the quarterly waves are keenly followed by policymakers, market watchers, and the media because of the enormous importance of cost of living to individuals and businesses alike. However, all this would not have been possible without the generous support from MasterCard and the continual efforts of MasterCard and the SMU teams in disseminating research results to the public at large through timely quarterly updates to the media. Our partnership is growing from strength to strength, and I would like to take this opportunity to extend my very sincere thanks to Vicky and his team from MasterCard Worldwide for their very strong support and more than support, the partnership that we have and that makes an important contribution to the large community through knowledge creation. It's therefore now my pleasure to invite Vicky to come to give you your address. Thank you.
Thank you, Arnold, for the impressive welcome. Thank you, distinguished guests, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and several of my colleagues that I see in the audience. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. Just about a year since we started the work on this index, and it feels good that it has done two things. One is it's vindicated our belief that we should work closely with SMU on areas as diverse as getting a few people ready for careers with some companies like ours, as well as trying to figure out things that could generally help data creation in a meaningful manner. In this particular case, we hope it helps in some ways to helping monetary policy in some effective way. So we do hope in some small way it does contribute towards that. But our belief is we like to look at knowledge management in a way that it can create a difference to businesses, to economists, as well as to regulators, so that we can have a better informed world where consumers can make smart choices, right? And that's sort of the thing. So once again, welcome to all of you for being here. You know, we look back at 2012 and we said, man, it was a heck of a year. It was a year with a fair bit of uncertainty to start with, which interestingly didn't bear out as badly as we thought. And, at the center of it is the Eurozone, which I think, you know, more rather than less would have said that it would collapse in some form or the other in 2012. And now there is a consensus that it will trudge along and probably won't go through a crisis through 2013, that's when I begin to doubt these forecasts. But let's see, let's hope that happens, and I would trust people like Manu and Dr. Yuma to give us some better insights on this Eurozone.
But so was that uncertainty in China. Right, there was a lot of talk on growth slowing down, inflation in China seems to have abated a little bit. I think most of us would believe that, you know, between a soft landing and soft growth, they'll get by pretty fine, they'll manage it pretty well. So that's not bad in itself. And thirdly, just, you know, turmoil around sort of various parts of the world in terms of just sovereignty and sort of human dignity. So I think there was a fair bit of uncertainty, and in all of these pieces you feel that maybe, let's hope, there are surveys and tests that bring about some certainty of life with people. With this index, or with indexes like those, if done correctly with the right representation, you always see that it does almost better than any other professional forecast. And as I think our two learned professors would tell us later, that we've probably done better than official forecasts in Singapore in this respect. So maybe we should do more. Maybe we should do it across various countries in Asia. So we'd love to do more with this index in a collaborative manner with universities outside of Singapore, with the central governments outside of Singapore, to create maybe then a strong repository of knowledge that can then start driving some decision-making more effectively. So that's sort of how we see this playing out over time, and really appreciate the support. I mean, Professor, you were kind enough to talk about sort of how we have helped, but for us, this was really an honor to be a part of, because we found a very good partners, we found a good way to work with the MAS in a meaningful manner, we found a good way to collect the data in a very professional manner, so we would love to do more of that as we go along. So this should not be the stopping place, this should only be a start place for us to do a lot more. We do remain, as I mentioned, really committed to knowledge leadership. We're doing a lot more work on consumer spend. We really believe in a world beyond cash, so we're trying to do all sorts of research as to what stops consumers from paying, what sort of motivates them to pay in cash, because again, as you start looking the whole angle of cash, the costs are immense and prohibitive to any economy. It's not just the cost of printing notes and delivering it to the banks and ensuring that the consumers get cash. That's probably 0.5% to 1% of GDP in most economies. You layer on that then all the cost that goes on in terms of handling that, in terms of the gray economy and tax evasion. You layer on that things like terrorist payments. You know, no amount of guns across from Mexico to the US or vice versa for wire exchange or for a credit card payment, right? It's all done in pure cash. So we strongly believe that the more we can do to build a world beyond cash and to get consumers alive to that fact and choices more often than not, we are fortunate in Singapore that it's evolved to a fairly significant sense, but we'd still love to kill all checks in Singapore and kill all inefficient payments and make that very effective as an economy. But other than that, listen, we're very happy to be here. We'd love to do more, and congratulations to everybody at SKBI, to Professor Aurobindo Ghosh, as well as Professor Junior, for really helping us push this along very nicely, very effectively. I think we're doing it on a quarterly basis, but again, as I said, as we can expand this, we'd love to do that a lot more. If there are other areas we should think about for Singapore, let's think about and do that a lot more, and you'd find us willing partners. Now, taking a lot of credit for work started by Dr. Yuva, so I'm going to stop short here and ask him to come up. And Dr. Yuva, just for somebody who doesn't know, has really been our ambassador in MasterCard for knowledge management. So not only is he a brilliant economist, more importantly, he's also a businessman as he thinks about how does data matter in people's lives and how do you make better decisions and choices. The only thing he's not helped me with is help me time the property market, you know, which is the only thing I frankly care about. So that being the only blemish in his career, let me invite Dr. Yuva, who's going to present to you the Asia Pacific Growth Outlook for 2013. Welcome, Dr.
The key message I'd like to share with you today is that I think now we need a fresh pair of eyes in order to see where growth will come from in the future. Because I believe that the global growth dynamic is changing and will be very different from the past. And to acquire this fresh pair of eyes, I think we need to first debunk two popular myths. The first is the myth of the economic decline of the US. And the second is the myth of the BRIC countries, BRIC, and by implication, the emerging markets. I think that the two myths stand more to confuse us than anything else about how we see a future of economic growth in the world. So let me begin by looking at how growth may change in the future. If I can switch the slides. Okay, I'll do this. Voila. Now, this is what it looks like between 2000 and 2010. On average, the world economy expanded by 6% per year, and this is calculated on the basis of purchasing power parity. Without that adjustment, it's about 3.7%. But the key is to look at the source of growth. Of the 6%, China contributed about 1.3%, the Eurozone about 0.6%, the remaining from the rest of the world. I think in the coming few years, it's entirely reasonable to expect China's contribution to be roughly two-thirds of that of the past, and to the extent that Eurozone will expand, is probably maximum at 20%. And if the rest of the world were to grow at about one-third of what it did in the past, then we end up with 2.3%. Now, if you're going to expand some of the assumption to a more sort of accommodating and optimistic level, but you're going to get up to 3-3.5%. You're talking about literally that the growth rate down by about half. And if you would look at the details closely in the previous decade, I would suggest to you that the expected slowdown is unlikely to be a cyclical phenomenon, but it's a structural. So this is what it looks like in terms of the details of the previous decade. In year 2000, our estimate of the private capital flow to developing countries is about $200 billion US. By 2010, it's a trillion US dollars. And correspondingly, that the growth rate jumped astonishingly between the beginning to and the end of the decade. So this is a tsunami of easy money that really created the rising water lifting all boats phenomenon. The fact of the matter is that by 2007, based on IMF's data, they cover 183 countries. All 183, with the exception of three, grew. And of that, 114 grew at 5% or more, whereas the previous two decades, only about 50 countries managed that. And of course, China's supply shock kept inflation relatively subdued. So this is convergence of a very powerful positive factor that created this phenomenon of rising water lifting all boat. And the fact of the matter is that you had to work bloody hard not to grow at that time period. And very few countries succeeded. It's Congo, it's Zimbabwe, and Fiji. So I believe this same confluence of factors is unlikely to repeat itself in the foreseeable future. I think it's going to be very different. So we got to, I think, debunk two myths. First, the decline of the US and the BRIC countries, and by implication, the rest of the emerging markets, to be able to see the where, the how, the why of future economic growth. So let me begin with the US myth. Now, this is a chart covering 62 years, 1950 to 2012, setting the US per capita GDP as 100, mapping against it four of the most advanced countries, France, Germany, Sweden, the UK. Not surprisingly, you can see the green line is Germany. 1950 is only at about 40% of the US per capita GDP. That's the devastation of the Second World War, and the post-war reconstruction is really getting moving at that time. But it peaked in about the mid-1980s at about 75% of the US GDP per capita. But if you start to fall back, stabilizing at about 70%. Sweden is the least war damage of the European Western European economies, so it started on a high note. But 72% of Americans per capita GDP, and it actually peaked at about 90% of the US per capita GDP, and start falling back and stabilizing at about 80. Now, you look at another set of countries, two advanced economies with very strong resource endowment, Australia and Canada, then two of the most successful East Asian countries, tremendous growth record in the post-war era, Japan and South Korea. So Australia and Canada is the same picture. They peaked around mid-1980s and so on, and then again stabilizing at about 80% of the US per capita GDP. The Japanese catch up, you can see here the purple line, and it peaked in the early 1990s at about 85% of the US per capita GDP, and then started to fall back and stabilizing at about 72% South Korea. Similar picture. Then you look at the BRIC countries, of course, they're much lower level. Russia actually peaked a lot earlier in 1975 at about 43% and suffered a catastrophic drop, okay, down to about roughly 13% of the US per capita GDP, then recovered to about 30%. China actually started the lowest among the BRIC countries, lower than India at 5%. And since the economic opening, it started to climb. Now, of course, they're nowhere close to where the other advanced countries are. But my guess is that should they ever get there, and assuming they do get there, they will get stuck at about 80, 85, 90% of the US per capita GDP. And the question is that, why is it so difficult to close the gap with the US? I think the answer, in one word, is innovation. I think all these charts show is that the American economy stands alone in its capacity to innovate, in its capacity for creative destruction. The American economy actually is in a constant state of renewal. So that's why my personal view is that, in contrast to a lot of the doom and gloom commentaries, I believe there's an economic renaissance in the making in the US. Led by the non-financial corporate sector, collectively has no debt, sitting on a cash pile of about $1.5 trillion. They're leading a surge in productivity. As a consequence, American exports are now increasing, its global competitiveness rising. And more importantly, the US leads the rest of the world in a very profound process of reinventing and redefining manufacturing, which is now becoming more knowledge and capital intensive. To set the record straight, I think a lot of negative commentaries about American manufacturing make the mistake of confusing the decline of manufacturing labor force with the manufacturing sector. 2 decades ago, the American manufacturing sector employed about 21 million people. It employs now about 11 million workers. But over the same time period, the value of American manufacturing output more than doubled. Put in perspective, 11 million American manufacturing workers today outproduce 170 million manufacturing workers in China. It's all about rising productivity. In the 1960s, your average Detroit auto worker made something like 7 cars per year. In the 1990s, it's about 16 cars. In 2011, it's 28 cars per worker per year. And these are much more complicated cars to make. So American manufacturing is not declining. It's becoming more productive, more innovative, and more competitive. And I think the shale gas revolution will provide very strong tailwind for the American economy over the medium term. Natural gas prices poised to drop to about a third of that of Europe and Asia in the US. This will prompt massive substitution of oil by natural gas, deploying an array of innovative technologies, which in turn will stimulate investment in such technologies. But to me, the most encouraging aspect of this economic renaissance in the US is that it's happened not because of the government, but in spite of the government. It's a case of American businesses and entrepreneurs returning to what they're best at, is reinventing themselves. So the future of the global economy will continue, that's my personal view, will continue to depend to a very large extent on the US as an anchor economy. The whole obituary of the economic decline in the US, I'm afraid, is very premature. Now let me turn to the myth of the BRIC countries. To begin with, they have absolutely nothing in common, except that they all have large populations. In fact, their interests are mutually contradictory. Brazil and Russia are energy and commodities exporters. So when commodity prices go up, they benefit, meantime hurting China and India, who are net importers of resources, and vice versa. China is only one of the four that replicated the pattern of East Asian economic growth, you know, mass labor-intensive manufacturing coupled with urbanizations and so on and so forth. And Brazil, actually, in many ways, is almost the opposite of China. China's been investing roughly 10% GDP equivalent in infrastructure in the past 2.5 decades. Brazil has, in the last 2 decades, invested less than 2% of GDP in infrastructure. So the infrastructure deficit is now literally choking Brazilian growth to death. Brazil's built a welfare state that it cannot afford. Government spending is about 40% of GDP. Tax burden is about 38%. These are numbers that you see in France and in Norway. So Brazil is now trying to engineer a policy U-turn to engage the private sector and so on, and we all wish, you know, it success. But meantime, the traditional model of Brazil is completely not viable in the future. I think Russia is in worse condition. There's absolutely no evidence that businesses in Russia, large or small, have benefited at all outside the oil and gas sector, and the government's totally dependent on that one source of income. Every time in the world price of oil drops below $100 per barrel, the government goes into a fiscal deficit. So I'm really not clear why Russia was included in the BRIC grouping to begin with, other than adding an R makes BRIC sounds a lot better than BIG. But beyond that, I don't understand it. But my point is that there's absolutely no reason in the future for the BRIC countries to grow together as a coherent group of economies. They will all have different trajectories, they have different challenges, and they have to come up with customized solutions to overcome those challenges. And what's true for the BRIC countries will also be more so true for the rest of the emerging markets. And I think that's the mindset we have to acquire. That's why I meant earlier by a fresh pair of eyes. Okay, we have to become a lot more discerning. It's no longer a sort of herd behavior type of emerging markets where it's at, and so let's go for it. And then as long as you're in the emerging market, you know, this is the place to invest. I really think we have a sea change. The market will behave and will look at emerging markets from now on very differently from the past. So with a weakened global demand, what's required is domestic demand from the emerging markets in it. And its most basic is investment and private consumption. Let's look at private consumption first. This is a contrast between the developed markets on the left-hand side, the private consumption expenditure in 2010, and 10 of the largest emerging markets on the right-hand side. So you can see the difference. It's very large. For the 8 developed markets in 2010, private consumption expenditure is about over $20 trillion versus about just under $6 trillion among collectively by the 10 largest emerging markets. So it's virtually impossible for the emerging markets to grow fast enough in its private consumption expenditure to compensate for any significant decline in the developed markets. And few, not many, on the right-hand side, the biggest emerging markets in terms of the domestic consumption market, China, about $2 trillion, followed by Brazil, 1.7, and so on. So that's a bit of a challenge. It's promising, but it's going to be slow moving. In the short term, it's really investment. And it's not just the quantum of investment, but the efficiency of investment. This is sort of a very rough, sort of illustrative curve to look at a trade-off between efficiency and the quantum of investment. This is what we call the incremental capital output ratio. The higher it is, the less efficient investment is. China today is about 3.8. In other words, China today needs to increase its investment by 3.8% to achieve a 1% growth in real GDP. That's way, way, way too high. It's very inefficient. So they should target 1.5, 2% and so on. So to the extent that emerging markets have actually increased the quantum of investment with an increase in efficiency, I think they can actually produce a lot of growth in a very short period of time. And the return is likely to be high because the difference in what we call the capital stock per capita, that's our calculation of the total productive asset in the economy. So this is our estimate for 2009, for instance, in the UK, what that means is $67,300 per capita of capital stock in the US. The higher it is, the more tools and so on there is for the worker to work with. In the US, it's 94,000, Australia is 100,000, Japan, incidentally, is close to 200,000. As a quick aside, and that explains to me, anyway, why for 2 decades, all the Japanese massive public sector investment project never worked in terms of igniting sustainable economic growth. At this level of capital stock per capita, the marginal return is practically zero. And that's why Japan has not been able to use public sector construction type of investment to boost economic growth. Now, in contrast, the emerging markets are very different. After 3 decades of heavy-duty investment in China, the capital stock per capita is only in 2009, $6,400 per capita. And I just look at the latest data for 2011, it's about 8,000. So it's very, very low. Malaysia is the highest in Southeast Asia, about, not counting Singapore. And Singapore is about 67,000, I think, 13,000. So to the extent that emerging markets can mobilize investment capital, and to the extent that they can be even semi-productive as the way it's deployed, they can really boost economic growth in a big way. But the bottom line is that for domestic demand to be an effective new engine of economic growth, the prerequisite is inclusive growth. And this can be roughly defined as growth that is broadly based, it's not based on one or two sectors, oil and gas, for instance. It engages businesses large and small. It benefits the vast majority of the households and the people in the society. And you can look at it in three specific levels. At the macro level, you require macroeconomic stability, managing inflation. Runaway inflation hurts the poor more than anything else, and provides sufficient liquidity for investment purposes. At the sectoral level, you have to move resources from low to high productivity sectors on a continuous basis. And at the individual level, you have to have the mobility for people to go from lowly paid underemployment to productive employment with high pay, and then the continuous process of upgrading the skills and so on. That's what I meant by inclusive growth. And I think for emerging markets, that's going to be the gold standard. Without that, domestic demand will not be effective. Without effective domestic demand, with a weakening global environment, you're in trouble. That's the connection. So inclusive growth will be the mantra, I think, of the future. And with inclusive growth, you would have sustainable and more balanced growth. And more importantly, you stand a better chance of generating a virtuous circle between investment and consumption. Because now investment begin to deliver benefits to more and more households who are now in a position to spend more, then in turn stimulate more business investment and so on. So that virtuous circle actually would be the answer for emerging markets to a slowing down of the global demand. So how are key Asian markets positioned with respect to inclusive growth? So this is a very rough one way to look at it, one particular perspective. We look at the Gini coefficient on the vertical axis, right? So the lower down it is, the more unequal the income distribution is. And then we look at the average of the last 3 years of private consumption expenditure growth. So you want to be in the upper right corner. That is, strong private consumption expenditure growth with equal income distribution. And you can see that that space is blank, more or less. Okay? So that's the challenge. That's where we need to get there. China has very strong growth in PCE, very poor record of income distribution. Right? Then you have South Korea, Australia, Taiwan, you know, very good record in income distribution, but the PCE growth is anemic, relatively. India is in the middling position, so is Indonesia. So I think that the country need to move to the upper right corner. It can be done. This is a quick example of how Indonesia is making progress. First, if you look at, you know, foreign direct investment, the race that is growing between Java and the rest of Indonesia is very encouraging. It's no longer Java-centric. You know, been growing about 10% in recent years, but 23% outside of Java. But more importantly, if you look at the right-hand side, is the calculation of percentage of the total loan lent by banks in Indonesia ended up in 1995 in Jakarta. To me, that is the height of exclusive growth. The end days of the Suharto regime, two-thirds of all the loans extended in the country ended up in, obviously, the, you know, the hands of a bunch of cronies and, you know, oligopolies related to Suharto's family. They said, but it's been coming down ever since. So to me, that's a very positive development. And also, Philippines, for decades, investment as a percentage of GDP languished at about the low teens. Well, guess what? Last year, it breached 20% GDP. It's not high enough yet, but it's moving up. And again, the reason is that because I believe investment in the Philippines now is now undertaken, not just, again, by a handful of oligopolies. It's businesses large and small and so on. It's in the game. That is a sign of inclusive economic growth. So, let me now turn to the short term. Okay, this projection for 2013, this year, a simple way of looking at private consumption year-on-year growth. That's our projection for the key markets and the year-on-year growth of investment. Right? Again, you want to move to the upper right corner, and not surprisingly, China is probably the best position for all the key markets in Asia to actually see the strongest ability to mobilize domestic demand in terms of investment and in terms of consumption. Okay, so that's what it looks like to countries. So, staying with the short term, just quick outlook for Asia Pacific. This obviously, and Vicky mentioned a number of them, pretty stiff headwind facing the region. First, the U.S. import is slowing. There's no question about it. Okay, so this is the year-on-year growth between 2010. It's still growing, but it's much, much lower. And my view is that it will stay low for the foreseeable future, because housing sector is so important. It's only stabilizing the end of last year. It will continue to do so. It's no longer dropping, which is the good news. Unemployment on the right-hand side, you can see, is coming down only very slowly. Another headwind is from the Eurozone. Eurozone, especially the crisis country, both the exports and imports are contracting at the same time, so it affects Asia big time. And even China is creating headwinds for the rest of the region, because Chinese exports likely to grow a lot slower. And this is what this chart purports to show. There's a very strong correlation between China's growth in exports and China's import from the rest of the region. Okay, so to the extent that Chinese exports can grow at a slower pace, Chinese imports from the rest of the region will be slower. The exception is Australia, by the way. Okay, so that's what it looks like. So it's another headwind for the region. But the good news is that the tailwind is this monetary policy will continue to be accommodating. But that's where I think the inflation expectation index is going to be so crucial. And I wish we had this, you know, on a uniform basis for the whole region, because that really would allow us to actually gauge to what extent what 2013 may look like from that point of view. So far it's still very accommodating, okay, but we cannot be complacent. In that regard, I actually want to point out that I saw the headline inflation for Singapore is 4.6%. So I'm so disappointed. I'm going to talk to Professor Aurobindo later, because his forecast for this year is 4.62%. I don't know what he did wrong. It's just, and it's 4.6. It's not 4.62. But anyway, so that's well done. That this is the kind of policy tool that we need. So let's just sum up for what it's worth, is our real GDP forecast for all the key markets in the region. And there's no surprises there. You know, China is going to go a bit faster this year compared to last. India is calculated on the basis of fiscal year, so we're going to stretch into 2014, but again, I do see improvement. Again, that's subject to inflation remaining subdued. And so monetary policy can continue to be accommodating and so on. But it's not a bad picture, okay? Many markets are still very tightly linked to the world trade cycle, so they unavoidably, you know, will get hit a bit harder with weaker global demand. But let me just end with an observation. Now, I've said about, you know, emerging markets will face tougher challenges in the future. There's no more rising water, lifting all boat kind of phenomenon of the past. But I also believe that the critical mass for emerging market is hit. And private consumption expenditures been increasing very fast. Most encouragingly is the expansion of the middle class on a global basis. For the last 20 years, if you look at household by income percentile, the segment between the 51st and the 60th of global households, this is 90% of the population of the world, so not all the countries are covered, but highly representative, grew by about 78%, higher than the top 1% that everyone's been talking about, which saw the household income increase by 60%. Well, who are these people? in the 51st to 60th percentile. 450 million people, turns out, in this segment. About 200 million Chinese, 90 million Indians, 30 million each of Indonesians, and Egyptians, and South Africans, and Brazilians, and so on and so forth. I think the momentum is there. We just have to get the rest right. And inclusive growth, okay, is, I think, going to be the key to the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for a very, very stimulating talk to Dr. Yua. And I would first, of course, plead ignorance to the charges that are given to me. First of all, it's not really my prediction or forecast to begin with. It's really the Singapore population who thought that that is the number it's going to be 1 year back. And the numbers are all there, so you can verify that number as well. So according to the SInDEx 1 forecast, which is done in December of 2011, the number for December of 2012 should have been 4.62. And it turns out it's 4.6, and that's in today's newspaper. So, you know, going back to this idea of forecasters or professional forecasters, and economists in particular, given that, and I plead ignorance to, well, I'm part of that group as well, but so I haven't really improved the reputation of the group as much. So I'm not doing the forecast again. It's the population who are making purchasing decisions who are the main people who are responsible for forecasting or expecting what the number is. What we did was really facilitate whether we can get the answer from them in a coherent way, looking at what Professor Demeyer also mentioned, a multidisciplinary research, and as President Bindra suggested, that this is something which is really a collaboration that's worth celebrating, because it's not a collaboration of doing academic work, which is probably going to be in some journal sometimes, but it's really looking at something which is relevant and which has a very long-term impact, which involves both businesses as well as households. Households make decisions to purchase. Businesses are making decisions on wages. And that is really something which is more of a collaborative decision-making process that we want to encourage into the future as well. So thanks again for coming in and sharing sort of a review of last year's numbers, as well as kind of a release of this year's numbers, which we have just received in December, survey of the data, and it is going out as a press release today. So this is joint work at Sim Kee Boon Institute for Financial Economics, and this is with Professor Jun Yu, who is also the director of the institute. I'm Aurobindo Ghosh, and the program director at this institute. So let me go ahead and go to this. Oops, sorry about that. Okay, so just a brief plan. I think Dr. Yua made my job very simple in discussing about the globalized economy and how there has been very good and strong trends. And his message on innovation and inclusive growth is something that should really ring true in most of the, not just central government, but policymakers in the region as well. So I will just outline, without the insight that he has, of what we find out are the current trends in the global economy and how this has an effect on in Singapore in particular. We will look at the data comparisons of different respondents that we found in the survey done with 400 individuals, and this is done every quarter at the time, which is 1 week after the release of the data on professional forecasters. So we are not really trying to second guess the forecasters. What we are trying to do is to see how much of that information that professional forecasters come up with sink in with the personal experiences of individual households as well. We will talk about, as I mentioned, inflation expectations, talk about SInDEx, the survey that was designed, and we don't have to really stretch our tongue that much to say it's still SInDEx. It's the Singapore Index of Inflation Expectations, so the initials are capitalized. And going back, we have to talk about the way forward and challenges, that real challenges that we face as not just individuals but as a country, so to say, in looking ahead into the future. So let me quote, and the best thing to do is to quote the economic counselor of in the IMF statements in 2012. In the foreword for all World Economic Outlook, and I'm happy to say that there has been a change of stance. I will end up with the statement of the managing director of IMF, Christine Lagarde, at the very end of the talk. So if uncertainty is indeed behind the current slowdown, and if adoption and implementation of macroprudential measures decrease uncertainty, things may turn out better than our forecast. And this rings so true. This is, of course, you know, it turns out sometimes better than our forecast in our daily experience. But not just in Europe. This is, of course, in context of Europe, but also in the rest of the world. I, for once, would be happy if our baseline forecast turns out to be inaccurate, in this case, too pessimistic. So I think this probably should ring true, that even though our profession is to try to predict what human behavior would be, but we are actually happy if the numbers come out to be better than what we expected. Because at the end of the day, that's what we are trying to do as policymakers as well, in this case. On the same note, a second quotation should be given about the context that we are dealing with today. It's talking about inflation and inflation expectations. And this quotation comes from Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke in a NBR Institute, Summer Institute held in Massachusetts in July 10th, 2007, so really nearly 5 years back. So high and persistent inflation undermines public confidence. I mean, this is critical. It undermines public confidence in the economy and in the management of economic policy, generally with potentially adverse effect to risk-taking behavior, which is, of course, essential for growth, investment, and other productive activities. So inflation really is in the top of the mind of policymakers in this particular case, central banks like the Federal Reserve, which has to deal with this problem as well. So if you look at the economic slump that has followed the great the global financial crisis after the fall of the Lehman Brothers in 2008, it was of course building up to that before that as well. It is really reminiscent of what happened after the Great Depression, and this is kind of well outlined that Ben Bernanke is one of the experts of Depression era economics, so he would really know a lot more about what happened and what policies were made at that time since the Great Depression. So this one of the critical issues in this period is the lowering of consumer confidence, because that plays a key role in economic decisions and the general mood of the consuming public. Now, G3, of course, includes the US, the Eurozone economies, and Japan had to resort to expansionary policies, and you can still see in the newspaper these things are still going on, whether it is the quantitative easing part 3 or QE infinity, according to Paul Krugman, who was giving a public lecture here some time back. And of course, Japan is announcing a stimulus plan as well to spend it going forward and to look at more of an inflation targeting, though there is some mismatch in the expectations there. And finally, of course, the Eurozone economies that you know, according to Mario Draghi, who is the ECB chairman, ECB president, he talks about this idea of outright monetary transactions, which essentially means that to shore up the banking system or the Eurozone economies, particularly the periphery ones, to try to improve by declaring that they are willing to buy out as much as it takes Spanish government or Italian government bonds. And that really lowered the cost of borrowing for these countries. So we don't hear that Spanish interest rates in the market are hitting close to 7% or so. It has come down, not because they have started buying, it's just the assurance that if it takes, they will go ahead and buy it. So that's very important, the critical bit of communication that is crucial in such cases. And finally, these expansionary policies have led to a huge amount of liquidity into the market. And this excessive liquidity, of course, increases a possible risk of inflation. And in normal circumstances, it will. But given the conditions right now, it has not. What we have seen that it is not yet rampant across the world. Though Singapore is unique in several ways, and we are going to outline that as well. But as a whole, in the global situation, inflation doesn't seem to be a huge problem as of now. It's really the lack of growth, which is more of a driving point. And that brings us to the next part bit of story, which is unemployment. Now, unemployment has been persistently high in the Eurozone, as you know, that Greece and Spain are really tackling challenges which are unprecedented, with 50%, over 50% youth unemployment rate. That's something that has to bother, has to keep policymakers awake at night. That, you know, how do you reduce these levels of unemployment? In US, even though it has come down of late with the re-election of President Obama, but even before that, that's about 7.8%. But the historic average in 1948 is only 5.8. So 7.8 is still 2% above that particular level. So it is definitely something that worried Ben Bernanke to decide on going into QE3 after he resisted that for the longest of times, because it was really something that it had to come down. Because if you look at unemployment, and that is definitely one of the two mandates that a central government has. One of them is, of course, to keep price stability, and the other one is improving growth and reducing unemployment. So as I mentioned, that this one of the causes or one of the medicines that was proposed is stimulus spending or easy policy, monetary policy, has led to, of course, historic low interest rates. So the way to handle this using interest rate reduction is not going to work anymore because it's already at the lowest level it has been historically, over the recent history that you've seen. So and this will go on till probably mid of 2015 with the own admission of Fed Chairman Ben Bernanke. So as I mentioned, that the two policies that are in the two of the G3 countries, our economies, US and the Eurozone, has played important role in trying to address the issue. But whether it has succeeded or not, it's going to only time will tell. Going forward with the effectiveness of stimulus is something that, of course, some people will agree, but it is it's a long-term plan to try to encourage businesses to start innovating again or starting to grow again. So the effect of it is mixed, and particularly because the horizon we are looking at might be sometimes too short for that to be effective. On the other hand, such expansionary policies do have a risk, and that's the production of huge amount of liquidity, or so to say, the hot money that might actually come back into countries with very interesting investment propositions, like Singapore. You know, it's a country with high levels of education, very informed and a very efficient workforce, and of course, a housing market which is very, very attractive to a lot of investors or a lot of investing capital out there. So this hot money might actually come back into countries like Asian countries in particular, which have been wiser since the global financial since the Asian financial crisis in 97, and that might have attracted a lot of money coming into Singapore. And one of the possible causes that you see some of these assets going becoming more expensive. On the other hand, Singapore also has to face another problem. Being a small, open, and trade-based economy, you see that it is susceptible to imported inflation. So what happens is that really, even though their prices would have been under control, but because of this easy monetary policy across the world, there might have been an influx of this money into it, and that might have caused imported inflation that Singapore is susceptible to, unlike countries like the U.S., or to some extent the Eurozone as well. So priority to reduce persistent unemployment was the key element of the decision making in the US of the policies that are made. And inflationary pressure became secondary because inflation in the US has been in one of the lowest has been since the global financial crisis. We outlined the region, what is going on in the region, but of course, Dr. Yua gave a very good context of how you can see the policies from the growth perspective in the region. But what you see here is that across the board, whether it's Vietnam, whether it's Indonesia, Australia has actually gone up since the stimulus spending slightly from July, but it has been off their historic, some of the highs that it has been over the last year. So they are really at low ebb. India is looking at a three-year low in inflation rate. China also is looking at about 2.6, which is also very, very low compared to historical averages. In Singapore, what we see is that the CPI all inflation rate in the third quarter was 4.2%, and the monthly rate of 4.3, and overall the yearly rate of 4.6, which was released in today's newspaper, so from the release from MASMTI joint release yesterday. So as comparison benchmark, the US inflation, of course, is at 1.7%. In UK, it's 2.7. Euro area overall is 2.2. And Japan, of course, shrunk at 2.2%. At 0.2%, so that's a deflation in Japan. So it appears that global trends, as I mentioned in the previous slide, is indeed to be on the lower on side on inflation. Now, one of the main findings, before I lose your interest, is that in the medium run, what we see is that there has been very effective communication from the policymakers here, which really have managed to anchor inflation substantially, meaning that, well, there's a very good linkages with the communication, so people are more informed about the medium term. And what we can see is the forecasted number, as Dr. Yua mentioned, that was 4.62 with the SInDEx 1 that we gave in both quarter 3 and quarter 4 had the same forecasted number at 4.62. And that turned out to be 4.6 overall in the year. But the quarter 3 data that we have, that number was 4.2. So, of course, we haven't been that close as the yearly number. But it is 4.2 is reasonably in the ballpark of the 4.2 that was predicted before. Of course, the Survey of Professional Forecasters is a survey done by on economists, practicing economists in different banks, and given about their information at that particular point of time, the median is the consensus forecast, and it seems to be moving closer to public's perception, even though it started off further down. It is moving closer to public's perception. The December 2012 data, as I mentioned, that the headline inflation actually went down slightly from the previous month's 4.57 in September. It is 4.37, and the 1 year SInDEx 1 calculated over, it's a weighted average over a few different types of inflation rates, is at 4.4 in December 2012 compared to, once again, 4.57 in September. This is in the ballpark. Now, this is looking forward, so that means the expected value of inflation 1 year later. So 4.4 seems to be in the ballpark range of 3.5 to 4.5%, which is expected by policymakers in their announcements. So the 5 year ahead one, though, on the other hand, which is the long term, so the medium term is more anchored, as I mentioned, but the long term seems to be a little higher than what you would think would be reasonable. So 5.2%, even though it went down as well, but there must be a reaction to lots of global uncertainties that are going on. So the anchoring bit that we have talked about might not be as much in case of, at least from the measurements that we have from the survey. So we are really looking deeply into what are the possible causes of such dispersion, because we have no benchmark whatsoever to know what inflation rate would be 5 years later. So we have no verification, and we will see the chart, which will be easier for us to guess as we go along. So let me move on into the basic decisions that are the comparisons of the data that we have. And what we see out there is, well, what we did was having a quota sampling of 400 individuals, and we don't take the same 400 individuals every year, every quarter, but a random sample of 400 from the panel that is given, and we compare based on their age criteria, so the distribution is representative of the population as a whole. And we find out that between 81 and 82% of the households that we surveyed, they are the people from the households are joint decision makers, at least joint decision makers of the household. 90 to 92%, these are huge numbers, who are aware of economic conditions that are affecting their households. So if not decision makers, they are actually at least aware of that. And 87% follow media report. So you can see the level of awareness is crucial. So it's a representative population. We haven't taken the sample based on these criteria. It's based on just the age distribution, and we found out such levels of awareness in economic decisions. If you go forward to what we see as the expectations of future conditions, it's varied. So expected household income increment 1 year later is expected from 0.73% in quarter one, last year quarter one, of these are all 2012 results, reduced to 0.4% in quarter two, went up to 1% and stayed about 1% in quarter three and four. In the 12-month time, there is also data on what they expected the appreciation of Singapore dollar would be, and it has been more or less stable. So they have actually been very much in sync with what policymakers have been given up. So the levels of communication, which I mentioned, is crucial. This is where you actually see whether the communication is done correctly, so there is no mismatch of expectations. In quarter one, the respondents, now this is actually critical, the last two bits. This is the levels of holding of securities in Singapore households. That means these are non-government issued securities, and it was 15.3% in quarter one. It went down to 14.5%, and then went back up again in 15%. So you can see that when you look at the exposure to the you know, in this case not the property market, but this is the market in the stock market, the equity market, and it has some kind of a rebound. though by a small amount. And this is the amount of investable assets that they have. And furthermore, we also see that the number of how much expects to continue to be invested in the market is about 14%, as opposed to a low of 12% in quarter three. So there has been a change of perception over the period. And that is very important, because it's not just the property prices. You're looking at how much assets have gone into the securities market. And this is crucial, even though it's a little low compared to other developing countries, because of course, the prominence of real estate, which forms a part of the investment of most of the households. This is quite critical. Going forward, what are the issues that might actually affect the inflation rate? So these are global issues. Last time in our review, we actually saw what are driving individuals to have expectations. Now, globally, we find that, well, of course, we are looking at an increasingly globalized world, and that has an effect on a small open economy like Singapore. So maintaining price stability and employment generation, these are really uphill task for any policymaker in such an open environment where you can be affected by everything that is going around you. So the things that the foremost important part that we find out is critical is imported inflation, even though that might have a lower effect now, but we don't have a very good way to measure how much imported inflation there has been. And the second, of course, is measuring the CPI all inflation, which includes all the items that are there, formed part of their basket, the appreciating real estate prices, accommodation prices, and private transportation costs, including COE prices, have just been released to go even higher somewhat in the open category to almost close to $100,000, as opposed to the other categories, which have gone down slightly. So those play a very significant role. Finally, the increase in wage rate. Now, this is in reaction to the things that I mentioned here. So wage rate, of course, increases the cost of doing business. And once the cost of doing business, then that will be passed through to consumers as well. So there indeed is an effect that you can see in case of... So all these factors play a critical role in the inflation rate that you actually have to face. I mentioned partly what we have seen before, and I wanted to just expand that a little bit more, is looking at this very free or easy money. I'll call it the big easy, because it's really getting a bit easy to have liquidity in the market. And liquidity does play a very, very significant role, and particularly given that the investment conditions in Eurozone has worsened substantially, it is going to trudge along probably at that level, and a reaction to imported inflation having a very strong Singapore dollar makes it a very interesting proposition of investment in Singapore. And that, of course, brings in a lot of this hot money probably into Asian, small Asian economies. Hong Kong would probably be included there as well. But I'm not going to just say it's a hot money which is coming in, which is just a reaction to expansionary monetary policy. But smart money might also be coming in. So smart money is a better investment destination. So people who are aware of the conditions, who are just trying to look for the best option of investment, might actually come into places like Singapore as well. And of course, there are some brighter sides. The outlook is looking rosier. So there is probably some green shoots which might sustain, given that the US housing market is probably not looking up, but is stabilizing, as Dr. Yua also mentioned. We see China having a very low inflation rate, and there are prospects like looking at the flash PMI numbers coming from HSBC. Looks at that number is more than Purchasing Managers Index is an indicator of what the future might actually look like. So that is more than 50%, which is one of the indicators of growth. And there might be other reasons why there are probably increase of the sentiment. So what we find, well, we have mentioned this before, but we want to just mention it again, that the Singapore Index of Inflation Expectation is a combination of different things. One of them is that we have different inflation rates which are calculated or expected out there, and we look at a weighted average. And James Bullard, the St. Louis Federal Reserve Chair, actually suggests that something like a combination would probably be better than using just a headline or even a core inflation rate. It's weighted across... So the standard rates that are used or that are there, we weight across all those rather than looking at a consumption basket that Professor Diemer also mentioned. We are actually looking at what people's perceptions are. So we are making them choose what baskets they are going to pick. So we are not going to go into the details of the basket itself, but look at their perception of what inflation has been like. And of course, stability, because combining these reduces the volatility, the changes of these type of index. So that's one of the arguments for the core index as opposed to the headline rate to be used for policy mechanism. So this is a much more stable one than either one of them. And finally, it's complete. It is includes all the different components of the basket without going into the details. What it does, it weights the ones which are more volatile slightly less. So that makes it a little bit better as a mechanism. So these are the numbers over the period, and we see that the numbers have actually stayed. It went down slightly in quarter three. These are all 1 year ahead forecast. So this is done in 2011 to 2012. So 1 year ahead, how the numbers has been looking. So 1 year ahead, we see around 4.37, as I mentioned. 1 year later, so about quarter four of 2013. Okay, so these are forward-looking measures. SInDEx is, of course, a little bit more stable and also slightly lower than most of the headline numbers because of the combination. And this is the number that we predicted then. It turns out to be around 4.6. And going forward, this is what we expect according to the data, what consumers expect, so to say. These are the professional forecasters. It's better off to look at this picture. Unfortunately, there was a slight typo. I'll mention that in the published working paper, and I'll mention what it is in just a second. So, as you can see, that this number is the purple line is the SInDEx number, which has been quite stable around this point. These are the professional forecasters 1 year ahead forecast for 2012, and you can see that they have actually converged to the number, but it has been a wide gap here. There has been some changes in the perception of individuals, but not by a whole lot, unlike the consensus forecast of them. This is the 2013 outlook from around 3%, it has actually moved up. So we see a level of convergence that is coming out between the consumers and the so-called the professional experts, who have, of course, different sets of data to look at. The professional experts are looking at the overall data in the economy. Consumers are only looking at their own experience. So we don't have to forecast exactly what is going on in the consumer's mind. They look at their experience. And that's why we see that this thing is much, much more stable than the professional forecasters. Of course, sample size does also play a role. Now, I have mentioned more or less the highlights of what we found out and how the numbers are indeed quite close to what the realization has been in the last period. I want to just move ahead, since given our time is coming to end before the panel discussion. If you look at the comparisons across the board, we see that indeed there has been differences over time, but the consumers are much more stable in terms of their perception as opposed to other numbers that are out there. It is indeed in the ballpark range, as I mentioned, of what policymakers expect the numbers will look like in 2013. Okay, so which is important to note, as I mentioned before, that there must be anchoring of these expectations going on in the individual's mind much more than it was before. Now, the 5 year ahead, though, is slightly different, and we are really looking deep into this, and these numbers are really very high, and we will probably have a chance to discuss that in the panel as well a little bit more, what the implications are. I will tell you a simple implication. So if the inflation rate expected is 5.39, which is, or even 5.2%, it has come down, as you can see, over time, so this is looking much better than what it was before. The important part is, with nearly rate of interest in the market to be close to zero, federal funds rate is 0.45, so the equivalent of a Singapore rate would be close to that as well. So a very, very low interest rate environment out there. At the same time, there's inflation, which is at nearly 5%, which means the real rate of return, the change of purchasing power, is at a negative 5%. Now, that is a crucial part of the story. So is it that true that people expect that their wealth is going to shrink over time? You know, in long term, means 5 years ahead. We don't have enough information to say that as yet. You know, maybe things will look up much faster and much sooner. And what exactly are driving these results? We found out that media plays a very, very significant role in such expectation formation. But maybe we need to do more to see what are the factors that are affecting it, affecting such expectation formation in future. This is, the prick picture of the 5 year ahead. And since we don't have any benchmark to compare it with, we see, once again, the numbers are quite stable over time. So this is 5 year ahead, what they see 5 year ahead. These are the forecasts that we have for 2013. As you see, it has gone down. This is where there is a small typo in the in the printed version, this number has a typo. This should be 3.2, not 3.8, which is mentioned. So the picture should look like this. It's gradually going up, once again moving up towards it. But that doesn't mean it will continue. It is possible that this is going to come down much more. So this is what people's expectations 5 years ahead are. But there are serious implications, as I mentioned. It's a decrease in purchasing power or wealth going forward, if such a condition actually exists. So we see this, as I mentioned, this strongly negative real interest rate or strongly negative perception of real interest rate in their opinion. And that is something which is very uncomfortable to think of from probably a policymaker side as well, that there must be some more communication needed to say that, well, that's not as bad because we are looking up. So you have to come down to a balance somewhere in the middle. So to just summarize the way forward, we will say that, well, this is really expecting the unexpected. You know, that's the reason for this. You know, we cannot expect something to change when every information we get is saying that, well, no, the inflation rate is actually not going up. But they somehow manage. It's the informedness, and as Professor President De Meyer also mentioned, it's the informedness of the Singaporean public, which is amazing. So I think kudos to them rather than the methodology to see this coming going ahead. It turns out that, well, even though the 1 year ahead or the medium term is quite well anchored and well grounded, the 5 year ahead seems to be a little on the high side, as I mentioned. Persistence, as we've mentioned, that, well, the expectations are actually quite stable over time. It is in the ballpark range, as I mentioned, between 3.5 to 4.5%, though a little bit on the higher side according to our calculations or from the data that we have collected. It has a substantial amount of anchoring, as we can see in the medium term, but the levels of uncertainty is probably what is driving this 5-year benchmark. Or since we don't have any benchmark, and I will simply reflect the same ideas as Dr. Wu and President Avindra has talked about before, is that maybe we need a benchmark. We need a benchmark in the region, which is a natural way of taking this around in the region. And it also gives you information about how people make decisions in the region as well. You know, what information they're looking at, how they're forming their expectations, so on. And maybe there is something we need to think about in future for a good benchmark option. And finally, challenges as policymakers. Imported inflation, even though it might be low as of now, but there's always a likelihood it might go up. Possibly with the commodity price increase. Right now, commodity prices are not really at a very high level as yet, but there might be a commodity price crunch. There's a food crisis that might actually happen. There's always a possibility of that. So all of these means that imported inflation, this might not be the end of it. There might be chances that it might go up, particularly given Singapore is an open trade-based economy. Effective communication, as I mentioned, is key. In the medium-term level, we find that communication has been quite effective. But then again, there's always a possibility of unhinged inflation expectations when we look at longer-term perspective. And finally, instill confidence. As I mentioned, that lack of confidence seems to be a driving force. Now, how can you instill confidence? Statements like Mario Draghi's, whether it's reasonable or not, it has policymakers to debate, but it did bring back some confidence in the Spanish bond market, so to say. There might be other instruments available, like a bond which is based on inflation, like TIPS or the Treasury Inflation Protected Security, that might be available for particularly fixed income or retirees, who are the biggest group. One of the issues that we have to deal with is the aging population in the region, and that might be something very useful as a portion of their retirement portfolio, inflation linked bond. And finally, to look at whether the future is perfect or imperfect, I'll quote, as I mentioned before, Christine Lagarde, who is the MD of IMF. We stopped the collapse. Well, we meaning IMF here, we should avoid a relapse. You know, it's kind of poetic somehow. And there is no time to relax, unfortunately, and that's for policymakers and individuals as well. Thank you very much.